Hi viewers, welcome to Akshaya Vlogs and Crafts. Today, let's see the next chapter. Ramakrishna had taken over so completely, he wanted to remove all traces of the body's first occupant. To some extent, he succeeded. Consider this account he wrote of his association with Swami Sivananda. That day, when I was half insane, knowing and yet not knowing my whereabouts, and was struggling like a ship, caught up in a storm, I came to the Sivananda Ashramam. Though I was almost a stranger, Bhagavan Sivananda acted like a lighthouse and gave abhaya, freedom from fear, calling me by his side. He gave me mantra diksha. This was the seed of knowledge implanted in the dry ground of Pichai's heart by his graceful personality. He watered and manured it by his nectarine upadesa, now and then, till it became a healthy sprout. Being well protected by his guru, Kataksha, it grew into a small sapling. On March 3, 1954, an armor was put on it by giving sannyasa, and I was set back to live in the world in my own house as sannyasini. The plant started bringing forth flower and fruit within the household fence from 1954 to 1968, being well protected all around. If it had continued to stay there itself, the raw fruit might have dried up and withered and fallen away without ripening. Hence, on 4th July 1968, it was removed to Vaishnavi temple in Madras to be under the protective care of the Devi. It started to ripen there. It was felt that the ripe fruit, if left on the tree, was likely to be eaten away by a crow, sparrow, squirrel or monkey and be lost. Mother Vaishnavi Devi wanted to give the fruit, when it ripened, to Guru Dev Bhagavan himself, who had planted the seed. The fruit came into the hands of Swami Chidananda, Guru Dev's beloved one and successor, so that he could offer the ripe fruit at the right time to Gurudev himself. In the late 1940s, Maragadamma took Tirupugalmani, a great Muruga Bhakta, as a guru. It is inconceivable to me that this Maragadamma, who had spent a lifetime being devoted to Muruga to the extent that she was permanently aware of him in her heart, would suddenly decide the spirituality she was struggling like a ship caught in a storm and in need of another guru who could save her, particularly one who was not imbued in the Muruga Bhakti tradition. It was simply Ramakrishna asserting his own desires, even to the extent of trying to exorcise the spirit of Maragadamma from her own body. I mentioned the story of the Kriya ceremony to a foreign woman from Ramana Ashramam yesterday. She snorted in disgust and said, "Typical man, first he moves in without permission and then he tries to kick her out of her own home." Did he succeed? I like to think that Maragadamma survived her funeral ceremonies and continued to exist as a silent and possibly liberated witness to the decades of her sadhana that Ramakrishna put in with Swami Sivananda. Perhaps her own spiritual work was done when she attained the Jiva Brahma Akya, the union of Jiva and Brahman, that she spoke and wrote about after her darshan of Bhagavan in 1950. Perhaps the second half of her life ran its appointed course merely in order to enable Ramakrishna to fulfill his allotted destiny with Swami Sivananda. I can't comment with authority on any of this, but I am encouraged in this belief by a foreword that she wrote for her own biography that came out in 1983. In it, she wrote, "He, Muruga, took permanent residence inside my heart, and his presence was felt whether I was awake or asleep. It is so from the time he entered my being in 1908 till this day, the Lord guarding me like the eyelids protecting the eyeball. He has shown me that he exists in all forms, that He is present in all names, and that He alone appears as father and mother, as uncle and aunt, as lover and the beloved, and as children and relations. He bestowed the vision of His divine presence in all His creatures and showed the way to serve them all with love and affection. I found the One Supreme reflected as many, like the one sun reflected as many in the waves of the ocean. My mind became calm and undisturbed, reflecting the Lord's presence as the placid lake reflecting the full moon. He is the Om, the source of all. He is the Lord Ganesha who removes all obstacles in the path. He alone appears as so many deities and is a serpentine power rising from the Mooladhara to the Sahasrara. It is the Lord Muruga who has taken hold of me completely and has protected me so far. And for the remaining small tenor of my life, may He keep me in peace and solitude to be in His presence only. Let me serve others in utter humility and affection. He appeared before me several times and blessed me. He who is in the past, the present, and the future enters into perishable bodies and residing in them, make them dance to His tune. He Himself is the dancer. He fills the cosmos as well as the atom. He has made this body bring out this story, or else how can this inert lump ever do anything? What is one to make of the central premise of this story? That following a curse, Ramakrishna became the co-tenant of Maragadamma's body. Swami Sivananda accepted it, and so did Swami Chandrasekhara Saraswati, the former Sankaracharya of Kanchipuram. He had great respect for Maragadamma and, recognizing the relationship between the two jivas, personally gave her permission to remain at home with the family after taking sannyasa from Swami Sivananda. He is also on record as saying that she, or rather Ramakrishna, is the only fifth Hindu on record to take up occupancy in another body, the others being Raja Vikramaditya, Adi Shankaracharya, Tirumular, Arunagirinadar. Since Swami Sivananda and this Shankaracharya are among the most respected spiritual figures of the 20th century India, the opinions have to carry some weight in this matter. Maragadamma did not remain in Madras for the rest of her life. She went back to Rishikesh and stayed there for many years. At the age of 89, when she became seriously ill, she returned to Madras and passed away there in her family home in November 1990. She was 90 years old at the time of her death. That's all for now, but let's see a story which was not given. In the year 1953, circumstances led her to the steps of Divine Life Center in Rishikesh, India. Swami Sivananda set her on a path of privation and rigorous duties. He initiated her in the same Shadakshara mantra as Muruga did when she was 9. Swami Sivananda instructed her to do 10 million mantras in a cave near the ashrama. Nothing deterred her from the path she had set upon. Not meager food, cold weather, insufficient clothing, or her humble surroundings. She answered only to the call of Muruga, who kept urging her to come and get him. One day she could ignore the voices no longer, and her footsteps led to an opening above the cave where she discovered an idol of Muruga. A voice emerged out of silence asking what had kept her so long, and asked her to establish him in a suitable place. The deity was placed by Valli's own hands in the ashrama's music hall. Eventually, she was given diksha, initiation, and became a sannyasini, earning a name Andavan Pichai and subsequently Andavanada Madaji. That was nothing new in his name. Since she was mad for the love of Muruga, she used to decry herself as pitchy, crazy for Andavan, God. Her husband, Narasimha Shastri, and children strenuously objected to her sannyas. Realizing she had not fulfilled her karma as a wife and mother yet, the Kanchi Shankaracharya gave her permission to stay at home until her husband's death. He had built her hut for her to live in after his death in Tamil Nadu, but circumstances again took her back to Rishikesh. She returned to Madras only when she was seriously ill at the age of 89. In 1988, she remained in Madras, served by relatives and devotees, until a Mahasamadhi on November 19, 1990. She left behind a legacy of wisdom in Tamil, Telugu and Sanskrit songs. On one occasion, songs to Devi poured out of her in the presence of Sringeri Shankaracharya, nine in all, each one a beautiful rendering of poetry, music and rhythm. At the end, Mataji, totally unconscious of her surroundings, was bleeding from the crown of her head. The Shankaracharya, holding flowers and kumkum from the Devi Puja, pressed a handful of kumkum to stop the blood. Once Mataji went to Nehru Samadhi, where some Brahmins habitually recited the Sri Rudram. When they saw her sitting isolation, chanting the Rudram, they took exception. They felt a lady should not be reciting it, and went to set separately to start their own chanting. To their bewilderment, they found they had all forgotten the words and could not proceed any further. Deeply ashamed and awed, they fell at her feet, asking forgiveness. They recited the Rudram together. Mataji's Kirtana songs were published at Kirtana Mala with musical notation in 1961. It was released at a function in Madras, at which many famous singers like M.S. Subbulakshmi, Musiri Subramania Iyer, S. Lalita honored Mataji by singing her songs in her presence. Today, these songs and many more are being spread by her daughter Kamakshi, who has started the Andavan Pichai Bhajan Mandali. Thank you, viewers. Bye-bye, viewers.